Hachette Audio presents Drink Beer, Think Beer, Getting to the Bottom of Every Pint, written and read by John Holl. For Hannah, I'll explain all of this to you on your 18th birthday at a pub in London. We'll discuss it further at a brewery here in the United States on your 21st. Introduction. A bottle of beer contains more philosophy than all the books in the world. Louis Pasteur. 4 decades ago, a few pioneers took risks with beer. Thanks to them, and to the consumers who wanted choice and thus supported their efforts, a brewing culture exists in America today that not only creates and supports local drinking communities, but has launched a global phenomenon. More breweries currently operate in the United States than at any other time in our country's history. Barring an extinction-level event, the number should continue to rise for the foreseeable future. More breweries mean more beers and more opportunities both to travel for a pint and to drink local. The industry's growth also means more experimentation with the world's second most popular beverage, coffee has beer beat, and therefore more options and more confusion every time you step into a bar. While it's a great time to be a beer drinker, the sheer volume of available choices can be overwhelming, even to the most experienced beer enthusiast. Trust me. For folks who are only moderately plugged into what's happening in the world of water, malt, hops, and yeast, it often seems easiest to default to familiar choices from large breweries that make their products approachable and relatable, thanks to heavy advertising and ubiquitous placement on shelves and taps. That said, in the same way that many folks are rediscovering the importance of eating food produced locally, knowing where that food comes from, and getting adventurous when cooking at home, a similar principle holds true for beer. We can settle for the status quo, or we can branch out and experiment. When it comes to flavors and beer, everything is on the table. Exotic fruits and vegetables, proteins, wood, herbs, and even a few things too gross to mention this early in the book. A hint, yes, some brewers use animal organs and other animal parts in beer. A bit of time and a little education can open up a whole new world of beer for even the most casual of drinkers. Finding flavors that suit a mood, situation, or individual palate makes beer a uniquely personal adventure, just like discovering a favorite dish at a restaurant. In no small part, because of this experimentation, breweries have become destinations. You'd be hard-pressed to find a general travel guidebook that doesn't mention at least one. Couples and friends build vacations around brewery visits, and enthusiasts will rise very early in the morning and line up outside a brewery to buy a limited batch of beer, as if it were an iPhone. Sierra Nevada Brewing Company's complex in Mills River, North Carolina, has earned the nickname Malt Disney World because of the awe and childlike glee its gleaming facilities bring out in adults. Brewers are treated like rock stars. Fans queue up at festivals for the chance to have a beer poured by their heroes, for a selfie, for a fist bump. I'm one of those fans, just maybe not the fist bump part. I'm someone who enjoys a well-made pint, who gets lost in the appearance of an amber-colored IPA, watching bubbles soar with purpose from the bottom of a glass to a ceiling of foam. The kind of drinker who gets wide-eyed and happy with the first sniff of sweet, strong, brown liquor rising from a barrel-aged imperial stout. I'll scratch my head trying to figure out the very specific flavor that comes and goes on the back of my taste buds. Hot pepper, thyme, coffee, and will excitedly talk flavor and nuance with fellow enthusiasts until last call. But I'm also a journalist. I started working in newsrooms at the age of 16 as an intern for a local public television station that aired a nightly newscast. From there, I moved on to newspapers, including 8 years at the New York Times, where I spent a good chunk of my career covering crime and politics, often the same thing. Each day brought a new story, new people to interview, new cities to explore. That was what I most enjoyed about the job. I woke up each morning knowing that I was going to work but not what my assignment would be. Now that I'm covering beer, getting up in the morning can be more difficult, depending on the night before. 3 months before my 21st birthday, my friend Mark Cregan gave me a subscription to a Beer of the Month club. Every month, 6 bottles arrived. I'd chill them down and try to drink them. Typically, they were bottles from New Hampshire's Smutty Nose Brewing Company, and because I respected this friend and his tastes, I was committed to giving each of them a shot. Dismayed, I inevitably admitted defeat in the presence of the hop bombs or other boozy concoctions and dumped them down the drain. But I was already intrigued about beer. I grew up in a house where my dad drank Heineken while the rest of my family downed Bud, or fondly reminisced about the days when Newark, New Jersey breweries like Ballantine and Pabst were ascendant. On the day I turned 21, I walked into my local brewery. There was, and still is, a brew pub in my college town that had, and still has, an English pub feel, a popular theme with many breweries in the 90s. There, at the Gaslight Brewery in South Orange, I ordered a beer that went by 3 letters, IPA, and choked it down. The bartender, a man named Jeff Levine, who would later become a friend, tried not to laugh as I forced myself to finish it. Against my better judgment, I ordered another. This time, I asked about the beer, and Jeff gave me a brief lesson in hops. Pine? Grapefruit? Those are familiar aromas and flavors, yes? They're supposed to be in the beer. The bitterness is part of the experience, he told me. I left feeling buoyed by my new knowledge and ready to learn more. As I started traveling for the newspaper I worked for, I found myself searching out a local brewery wherever I landed. Often in those days, it was a brew pub, and I'd wind up there without fail for dinner or a nightcap. And I did this for 3 reasons. 1, brew pubs had better food and beer than the lobby bar of whatever Holiday Inn I was staying at. 2, local places gave me a more accurate feeling about the vibe of the town or city, adding important nuance to whatever human tragedy I was there to write about. 3, I could keep learning about beer. I was purely learning as a fan back then. It took years before I felt comfortable writing as an authority on the subject. Soon, I had graduated from covering crime and politics and transitioned to writing about beer. I started by working for small print operations like Ale Street News and Celebrator Beer News, monthly papers that covered the East and West Coast respectively, and were run by industry veterans and staffed by longtime freelancers. I learned about the nuance of local beer reporting and the proper ways to write about beer flavors. I became a news editor at Ale Street and loved the alt-weekly vibe of the coverage, getting into odd corners of the industry, interviewing still obscure brewers, trying to spot trends among the dozens of press releases that arrive daily. In 2009, I was hired as associate editor of the short-lived national publication Beer Connoisseur magazine. While there, I profiled beer industry figures like the heads of Samuel Adams and Dogfish Head, and broadened my coverage and reviews to include international beer. In 2013, I was named editor of All About Beer magazine. Founded in 1979, it's the country's oldest beer publication. I spent nearly 5 very happy and productive years reinventing the magazine's pages and collaborating with talented writers to craft in-depth and illuminating stories, all while working with some of the finest people I've ever had the privilege of calling colleagues. I also traveled the world, writing and reporting from 5 continents in nearly every state. In 2017, I was named senior editor of Craft Beer and Brewing magazine, where I continued to cover the beer industry as well as home brewing, the hobby and passion that really kicked off today's beer renaissance. Along the way, I've hosted or co-hosted several beer-themed podcasts and covered the industry for publications like The Washington Post and Wine Enthusiast magazine. I've even written a few other books, including the American Craft Beer Cookbook, which celebrates pairing good beer with good food. These days, as a journalist who covers beer full-time, I have the privilege of often being front and center for truly remarkable events and conversations throughout the brewing industry. My access, along with a healthy curiosity, exhaustive travel, and research trips around the world and around the corner, coupled with my duty to share what I've learned from professionals, fellow drinkers, and quite a few history books, has led to the audiobook you're now listening to. Beer is more than a combination of ingredients in a pint glass. There's a whole orbit of other elements around that glass to acknowledge, appreciate, and understand. Beer has an economic impact. It's a social convention. There are family ties to beer, fond or not, memories of what your parents and grandparents drank. Conversations with colleagues about humorous or not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.